we can't afford to keep doing the same thing, aplas pickles and you know, selling the same rotis every day. We got to do something. Social hybrids are the norm today. Can we build them? Development is not charity, and we need to distinguish this. And so we do a lot of things. We say it's culturally appropriate, contextually relevant development. We believe medical healthcare has to be integrative medicine. I do not believe you can mainstream Ayush. I hate that word, mainstream Ayush. I believe we actually pushed away Ayush and sort of put in allopathic medicine there. So we believe Ayush is mainstream. Let's start accommodating allopathy. And so our hospitals are moving towards Ayurveda now. So we promote, like I said, economic advancement. We're expanding human and social capital. We leverage technology a lot. All our materials are edutainment. We do a lot of stuff. Now we have solar powered, we have vehicles that got solar panels on top. So whichever field areas we go to, we can show videos, we can light up the whole thing, build up a stage. We have been using technology extremely well. That's the science park that you see in the small, it's too small. And for us, it's about celebrating cure rather than stigmatizing disease. It's a huge difference there. That's why we can manage tuberculosis, HIV, etc. very well. And we collaborate between young and Indian professionals. We run an institute in Mysore called Institute of Indian Studies. As much as I come to US to teach, I get students from 20 universities, Harvard, Cornell, Princeton, Michigan, all the top names in the US to come and study with me. Vivekananda said the East has got as much to give to the West as the West has got to give to the East. And so let's make it happen. We have a lot. Indian art, culture, history, civilization, gender, sustainable technology. These are stuff which we teach and students come all the way to learn. So it's time we start taking pride in what we do and not just look to taking. We can actually give. And we get students from Canada, from US, from England, from Australia, from Singapore. And we're keeping on expanding that. So for us, finally, sustainability means it has to be multidimensional, it has to be multi-pronged. Organizationally, it means good practices, good governance, best practices in management, and building second line leadership. I'm away 50% of the time from my organization. My organization does better, actually. So if you build second rank leadership, they actually do a damn good job. Most founders don't know how to let go. I had the same challenges, and it's all very difficult. You know, we fall so much in love with ourselves that we don't step aside at all. And so we need to learn to step aside, and that's not part of the Indian DNA. So we got to do it. Corporate India is learning it. Let non-profit India learn it. So for us, sustainability is about our projects and programs. Can we really get local human resources? 87% of the people working in my projects, 700 people are working across Karnataka, 87% of them are local boys and girls. They do a damn better job than us. We train them, we get them degrees, we teach them English. There's a lot of things they do. And we have leverage local funds, we have revenue generating models. I charge. If I run a training program for corporates, if I come to the US and do a program for one day in the US, I charge $10,000. People at Harvard tell me I'm cheap, but $10,000 is good enough for me. Not for me, it goes to my organization. Well, it's a corporate rate. If an NGO comes to me for leadership training, I charge nothing. If the government comes, I may charge them $2,000 a day. If I come to US, or if I do it for an Indian corporate, it's $5,000 in India, it's $10,000 in the US. Well, that's the price you pay, and that money goes back into our work. So that, I said that's a cost of intellectual capital. I have built intellectual capital over 31 years, and if I can offer it to a corporate India to run their corporate better, they better pay for it. And that money goes back into development. So we can leverage such revenue generation models. We do a lot, so we believe again, create social capital, create human capital, economic capital you can create by itself. So what are the good practices? Why did we get this award? Mohan told about this award that we got last year. The Edelweiss Foundation, Rockefeller Foundation across the world have a 1 year long due diligence process, and they try to give the NGO award to the best NGO, what they call the best NGO. And there are a lot of factors they look at. And I was looking at and thinking, more than they're identifying us, I want to say what made it work for us. What can local NGOs copy? Invest in local manpower. Invest a lot in capacity building. The world of development is rapidly changing. We can't be caught behind. We can't still be talking about just, you know, stuff which is roads, bus stands, and schools. And we've got to go beyond it to understand schools are not learning. Learning is different, schooling is different. And what is the difference? How do you make learning happen? How do you measure learning outcomes? How do you get communities to measure learning outcomes? How do you get communities to actually teach and train people? Four of my teachers are tribal boys and girls. One is a chieftain, one is a chieftain's wife. And what are the knowledge they bring to the table? How do we actually make them transact in a classroom environment? We can do all that. We have to look at community-driven inclusive development, where the community is always a partner, never a beneficiary. I think most of us think, I give you a house, I give you drinking water. There's a sort of provider-taker relationship. In our programs, they're only partners. I have some tools, you have some needs, I have some skills, let's see if we can combine. Get professional approaches. We need to train ourselves. Everybody is an expert now in development. It doesn't work that way. Then you wouldn't have Kennedy schools and other places teaching you development. Obviously something else. I keep telling my friends, I can't go into the operating room of my hospital and give anesthesia just because I founded this organization. Giving anesthesia is professionally trained skill. It happens after 2-3 years of training. Similarly, somebody else can't come in and say, I'm going to teach you development. Development is also a professionally trainable skill. Learn all the time. And I heard a lot of you speak about learning. I think that is the secret. You keep doing it, you keep doing it. And let's pay reasonably. Some of this myth that NGOs shouldn't be paid well, right? I think you give peanuts, you only get monkeys. And that's the reality. Now let's change this paradigm and say, if somebody wants to commit his life for rural India, so be it. I get a lot of highly trained, committed young graduates to come and join me. I can't give market salaries, I know. A doctor joins me in market areas, he earns 200,000 rupees a month. I pay him 50,000. What are the other NGOs pay him? 10,000. Well, I say losing 1.5 lakhs is his contribution to rural India. But if you say he has to only take 10,000, obviously you're not going to get a doctor at all. So we have to be realistic. Let's look at paying reasonably. And don't put your eggs into all in one basket. Now, I think the major problem, like our total funding from government is 8%. I haven't got money for the last 3 years from Government of India. I never bribe, I fight, I take them to court, but I would never let the government get away. I believe we must get their money. It's my money, it's taxation revenues. I might struggle, but I don't give up. So working with government is a philosophy for us. And we put our eggs in multiple baskets. It's only 8%. Corporate India is only 43%. We have a 501c in the US. We have a charity commission exempted organization UK. So we have put our eggs in many baskets. And that's how sustainability is planned. We build partnerships. We build relationships. Very difficult working with government, but they are the most permanent institution you have. We work with other NGOs. And this is a big problem for NGOs. Now, I think we have mega egos in this sector itself. No, we two NGOs don't know how to work together. No, we just don't want to get along. And I think that's a big problem. Can we subsume personal egos and learn to work together? We can actually don't have to keep discovering the wheel. So we work. We work with as many funding partners. We only don't take money from the tobacco industry, from alcohol industry. We have our own internal decisions, internal ethical frameworks that we follow. We work with corporates. We work with what we call sensible and sensitive corporates. That's the word I use. So we do our, I tell the corporates, what do you mean you do due diligence of me? I do due diligence of you. I decide whether your money is worth taking. That's the way I operate. You can say after 30 years you're there. But it doesn't matter, from year one I've been there. I always tell people that I should know whether your money is worth taking. And you can actually set the benchmark like that. You know, like I said, transparency, accountability, monitoring, evaluation frameworks. One of my specializations I did in Harvard was, how do you measure performance? What exactly is performance? What does performance mean for government? What does it mean for us? We can actually measure. How do you report it? What is it to be innovative? What it is to be sustainable? Yeah, I'll be done. It's only one slide. What it is to engage? How do you engage? And how do you make learning integral to your DNA, to organizational culture? Set high standards of governance management. Respond to the external and internal environment very sensitively and sensibly.
This is Justice Venkatacharya. Particularly emphasize about the Vivekananda youth movement. The first is that it's the economic model, the economy with which results are achieved, the carefulness with which money is spent. Secondly, it's highly professional. Whatever work they do, they plan out properly, think it out, think it through, and see that the best thing that can be done is best for the job. The third is, it's a very transparent model, that this kind of transparency of working, of funding, of auditing, of accountability, this is something which should commend itself as an ideal for the prototypes of this kind in the country. Vivekananda youth movement is really a metaphor for the change that we wish to see in India.
This is a big question. If you have any questions, ask me. And like I said, that is not just a story, but this new paradigm of how do you build human and social capital, how ordinary people make a difference.